Unlock the power of regeneration. Come explore futuristic techniques to help grow back cartilage without going under the knife. I'm Dr. P. I'm an orthopedic surgeon. You got a problem with your knee? Come see Dr. P. Today is another mailbag session, and I get a lot of comments, and thank you all for the comments and questions that you add in the comments section below, which we still want more because that's how we get a lot of our technique. But very common question I have is, are there non-surgical techniques for cartilage repair or to restore my cartilage or maybe even to prevent me from losing cartilage in the first place? So I group these together into different categories. One is, people ask, will exercising, physical therapy, stretches, whatever, exercises help me to grow back new cartilage? So there's no doubt that strengthening your muscles, our muscles are our main shock absorber, okay? So what our muscles don't absorb, then the joint has to absorb. And if the joint is starting to wear down, the cartilage, the tread and the tire is starting to wear down, or the meniscus, which is the shock absorber cartilage, is starting to wear down, then more and more force is going to get transmitted to the bone underneath the cartilage. Bone has millions of pressure sensitive nerve fibers, and that's why we get pain in our knees, for instance, or our hips or wherever when we have arthritis. So yes, strengthening the muscles is going to absorb more of that force. When we walk, we land with about 3 to 6 times body weight, just walking, going up and down stairs, or running or jumping, it can get to over 10 times body weight. So by strengthening those muscles, it will take the force and off the damaged joint, but it's not gonna grow back new cartilage. So I don't think that's gonna be a way to do it, but it's gonna certainly protect your knee, help your symptoms, and maybe lessen or slow down the rate of cartilage wear and tear. So I do think it's still valuable. Same thing with stretching. Stretching is going to loosen up tight joints if they're overly tight. That might add more pressure. If it's too tight, there might be too much pressure there, and that will give pain. So stretching, look at Tom Brady. You know, he played into his 40s, a lot of stretching, some strengthening, but he was very flexible. So being flexible will help our joints as long as you're under the treatment of a professional who knows exactly how to stretch. But in general, stretching is not gonna grow back new cartilage either. So it might take away some of your symptoms from having arthritis, and it might slightly lessen the risk, but I don't think there's any studies for that. But I know it's not going to grow back new cartilage necessarily. Now, if you've had a surgery to help repair your cartilage and you do exercises or motion, that there are some examples where that can help cartilage grow back. Or if there's been an actual damage injury to the cartilage, sometimes we put people in a machine called a CPM, continuous passive motion, and that actually can help stimulate cartilage growth. So our joints are made for moving, and the more movement you do, within reason, the healthier your cartilage is gonna be. So in general, I would say physical therapy, exercises, stretches, etc., all great, but they're not necessarily going to grow back new cartilage. And even, the exercises or a physical therapist, they may also find some imbalances. Some people have bow-legged, some people have knock knees, some people have flat feet. There are ways to use orthotics, braces, even these things called offloader braces, which are kind of a spring-loaded brace, which can take the pressure off the damaged or the side of the knee that's wearing out more. But again, it's not gonna grow back new cartilage. So those questions about therapy, bracing, stretching, they're not going to grow back new cartilage, but I do think that they're valuable still. People wanna know, is cortisone or gel injection, hyaluronic acid injection, is that going to grow back new cartilage? Well, the gel injections, hyaluronic acid. Hyaluronic acid is the same, almost like motor oil fluid or component within our synovial fluid. So our joints have fluid, which lubricates them. And when you get older, that thins out. It's not as good of a lubricant as it used to be. So they make these artificial joint fluid shots, which you can inject, we can inject into the knee with a needle, and it thickens up the fluid, kind of like a motor oil change, but it also stimulates your joint to produce better fluid. So it tends to last longer than a cortisone shot. I don't think there's any studies that prove that it grows back new cartilage, however, but it will improve the, at least temporarily, for about 6 months, sometimes a little longer, sometimes less, the fluid within your joint, and it will help your joint symptoms. Cortisone definitely will not grow back new cartilage. Matter of fact, there are studies that show that people who get cortisone tend to develop arthritis faster than people who don't get cortisone. So cortisone should be very sparingly used. It's very good anti-inflammatory, so it decreases swelling and inflammation. So that's about the only time I'll ever use it if we really need to get inflammation down. If someone has a golf tournament in 2 days or 3 days or 2 weeks, and you really need to get that inflammation down, that might be a good treatment for that, but it definitely will not grow back new cartilage. As a matter of fact, too much cortisone will damage cartilage. That we know. So I'm not a big fan of it. Another non-invasive treatment that I think could potentially grow back new cartilage, and there is some science behind this, is laser therapy. So there are certain wavelengths of light which can penetrate through our skin all the way into our joints, okay? And there's little mitochondria inside our cells. So our cells have these little things inside them called the mitochondria. If you remember from high school biology, the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. So by stimulating that mitochondria, the mitochondria produces more ATP, more energy. It's like recharging the batteries of the cells. But there's also proteins and other things that mitochondria will release that will help the cells work better or help the surrounding areas function better, including nitric oxide, which can stimulate the dilation of your blood vessels, so it increases blood flow to the area. So nitric oxide is known to increase blood flow. So the laser does four main things. It stimulates the mitochondria, it decreases swelling and inflammation, and swelling and inflammation we know can cause pain. It increases blood flow to the area, and a lot of times cartilage, tendons, ligaments, they don't have the greatest blood supply. So the more blood supply you have in the area, the better chance you have of healing. And the fourth thing is the laser can decrease pain by inhibiting the painful nerve fibers and nociceptors that cause pain. So there is some potential, especially if there's been an injury, for laser to help heal cartilage. But I don't think that repeated laser treatments have ever been shown to grow back new cartilage like good as new. So if you have bone on bone and you're being treated with laser every day, I don't think your knee's gonna be back to where you were 18. So it's not going to grow back new cartilage. We really don't have perfect ways of growing back new cartilage yet, but we do have things such as PRP and BMAC. So PRP stands for platelet-rich plasma, and BMAC stands for bone marrow aspirate cells or bone marrow aspirate concentrate, depending on who you talk to. And so our bodies have all kinds of healing factors in them and all kinds of cells and proteins and things like that that heal us every day. Every day we walk, we break ourselves down a little bit and our bodies heal ourselves and we don't even realize it. We take it for granted. However, there are ways to harness that healing power in our blood, in our bone marrow, and use it to help heal or grow back other areas. This is all relatively more recent technology, but it has been around for quite some time. I think the first PRP injection I ever performed was in 2008. The first bone marrow injection I ever performed was 2017. First time I used laser treatments was 2017. So it has been around a while, but we're getting better and better and better every year with this stuff. So PRP stands for platelet-rich plasma, and I've done a bunch of videos on this, but in short, the platelets are those things that when you cut yourself, you form a scab, they stop the bleeding, and they release growth factors. And those growth factors stimulate new blood vessels and cells to come back in the area to help healing. So PRP is more like fertilizer. It has growth factors. I don't think there's any studies, however, that show that when you inject it into a joint, it's going to grow back new cartilage. It will help repair damaged areas of the joint, the lining of the joint. It'll make the fluid better. It'll kind of restore and remodel the inside of the joint. It'll decrease inflammation. And I'm just being very simplified here. There's a lot of other things it does as well. But the bottom line is, if you have arthritis in your knee, there are many studies, at least 37 studies out there, that show that PRP can help people who have arthritis in their knee with their symptoms. And it's better than cortisone and hyaluronic acid, which I just talked about. So there's studies that show that as well. And it lasts longer. But again, to answer everybody's question here, they want to know what grows back new cartilage. I don't think PRP grows back maybe any new cartilage, but if it does, it's very minimal. So that's PRP. Now the bone marrow cells, that's a whole different story. We have cells in our bone marrow called stem cells. And the bone marrow is actually pretty cool because it has two types of stem cells, hematopoietic and mesenchymal. Big names, but hematopoietic means that those stem cells, which are cells that haven't turned into anything yet, those stem cells are gonna turn into blood cells. And there's all kinds of different red blood cells, white blood cells, platelets, all that stuff. They're gonna turn into that. Mesenchymal cells can turn into cartilage, tendon, bone, heart, liver, skin, things like that. So the bone marrow has both of those in it. We also have stem cells lining all of our blood vessels, our capillaries. They're called pericytes. When an area gets injured, those stem cells either go into action and help heal, or they go into action and they tell other cells what to do. So even in our fat, believe it or not, we have stem cells that can help with the healing process and the restorative and the regenerative and the reparative aspects of what our body does for ourselves. So there are a lot of different areas that we can get these cells from, but I personally like the bone marrow, and that's why you hear a bone marrow probably more than adipose, which is fat cells. But either one, you can get stem cells from. They can be injected into a joint that has arthritis, such as the knee, probably the most common. There's not a lot of long-term studies that show that just injecting those cells in there by themselves is going to make that knee from a 55-year-old knee to an 18-year-old knee, but there are some studies that do show it has grown back some cartilage. So it's not perfect yet, but that really is the only way that we have right now of growing back cartilage. There are surgeries that can be done where you take some cartilage out, send it off to a lab, they grow new cartilage, and then it's reimplanted back in the knee. That's usually for bigger areas of cartilage loss. Right now, we're not allowed to do true stem cell injections, meaning we're not allowed to take those bone marrow cells or those fat cells, send them off to a lab, culture them, grow them, multiply them, mail them back, and inject them back in. That's not allowed by the FDA right now. So when we talk about bone marrow and adipose, there are stem cells in there, okay? But there's other cells that help the stem cells. There's also blood in there. There's other factors in there other than just straight stem cells. And sometimes that actually works to our advantage. And sometimes it may not work as well as eventually when we're allowed to multiply the cells and inject them back in. So in general, to answer all these questions, you know, how do I grow back new cartilage? We still don't have great ways to do it. Like the meniscus cartilage, the shock absorber cartilage, we really have no good ways of growing that back yet. There's a lot of research going on, and we will eventually. Really, the only way to grow back some cartilage is right now with the either the bone marrow cells or the adipose cells, which have some stem cells and other cells that help the stem cells. But really, all these things I mentioned, they're all, other than cortisone, they're all great ways to help your knee joint pain or whatever joint is bothering you. They can hopefully help prevent it from getting worse or slow that process down as well. So they're all very valuable. I would get in with a professional, find out what the actual diagnosis is first, and then some, one, or all of these can be very helpful. So I hope I answered that question. Again, we don't have any perfect ways of growing back new cartilage to completely make a joint normal. The bone marrow cells are probably the closest we have right now. I do use those a lot, but we don't have a perfect way yet. But every year we're getting better, and eventually we will be able to do that. And then I even think someday we're going to be able to prevent arthritis in the first place. That'll be gene-based therapy and stuff like that, which people are working on. So I hope this helped. And again, follow us, like us, comments, questions. Thank you so much for these questions. Remember, if you got a problem with your knee, call Dr. P.